Okay, let's get started. Welcome back to the second morning session for today on multi-wavelength manifestations, with the first invited talk by Andrea De Luca on CCOs and the slow magnetar in RCW 103.
I thank the organizer for inviting me to this wonderful meeting. Before starting my talk, I would like to spend two words to remember Giovanni Bignami. He was a dear friend and collaborator, and needless to say here, he was a major contributor to neutron star astronomy and to science in general. He left us last May, and we all miss him very much. So, ciao Nanni, and I will go back to the topic of my talk. In this slide, I show you the identity kit of a central compact object. CCOs are soft X-ray sources sitting at the geometrical center of supernova remnants. And so, assuming that they are genetically tied to the host supernova remnant, they should be young astrophysical objects. Their spectrum is thermal and is typically well described by the sum of two black body curves with a very small apparent emitting areas. They have no counterparts from the radio to the gamma rays. There are no associated pulsar nebulae, nor any other kind of hints of non-thermal emission. Their emission is generally steady and unpulsed. So, what are CCOs? I will go during my talk looking for a template by studying different objects that have been well characterized, and several pictures are emerging for them. The first source I will be talking about turned out to be a very peculiar magnetar. This is the central source in RCW 103 supernova remnant. Interestingly, it was a sort of a prototype of central compact object. It was the first proposed radio quiet isolated neutron star in a supernova remnant. It was discovered by Thuringer-Meyer using Einstein data, and the proposed interpretation was at odds with the evidence of long-term variability that came later in the ASCA and Rosatira. Then, in the Chandra and XMM Newton era, came the evidence for a possible periodicity. Around 6 hours was the period. It was apparent in the first Chandra observation. It was not apparent at all in the first XMM Newton observation. But in 2005, thanks to a long observation with XMM, we could assess that the source is unambiguously periodic. And the period is around 24 kiloseconds. This is the light curve. As you can see, it has a sort of scene-like shape at that time. In this plot, I show you all the kind of time variabilities that we know from this source. In the larger panel, you see a long-term light curve. Here you can see flux measurements from Rosat, ASCA, again Rosat, ASCA, Chandra, XMM Newton. As you can see, there are strong evidences for large variations in flux, large outbursts, let's say, recurrent on the few years timescale. The inset shows the short-term periodicity at the 24 kilosecond period. As you can see, when the source is at a high flux level, the modulation is complex, with multiple peaks and dips per period, while when the source is at a low flux level, the modulation is much simpler in shape, with a sort of scene-like variation. At the time of the discovery of the periodicity, we had the opportunity to perform a very deep observation with the VLT, and we could not identify any viable candidate counterpart in the near infrared. Our upper limits ruled out the possibility to have a star larger than an M6 dwarf as a companion to the source. And thus, putting all the things together, recurrent outbursts, the long periodicity, the young age, the lack of a counterpart in the near infrared, we had to face a sort of unique phenomenology which called for very unusual explanations. And so different interpretations appeared in the literature, ranging from an isolated magnetar, possibly braked to 24 kilosecond rotation period by interaction with the fallback disk, to binary systems involving very small stars, or indeed a magnetar together with a small star. Since that time, we have been monitoring the source with SWIFT, and this is a long-term light curve spanning more than 16 years and showing the decay from the outburst occurred in 2000. The evolution can be described as a cooling and shrinking of two hot spots, and the overall energy is about 10 to the 33 ergs. Using SWIFT data spanning several years, Paolo Esposito had produced a phase coherent timing solution which allowed us to put some constraint on the evolution of the period to, let's say, two times 10 to the minus 9 seconds per second. Then we have been continuing the monitoring. We were not any more excited in the last years since the source was persisting in its very low level, but eventually last year the source reactivated. On June 22, the Burstaller telescope on board SWIFT was triggered by a short flare of hard X-rays coming from a direction that was consistent with the position of the CCO. This is the error circle for the origin of the hard X-ray burst. This is the light curve. As you can see, the duration is very short, around 8 milliseconds. The spectrum is thermal, and the luminosity at peak is around a few times 10 to the 39 ergs per second. As you can see in the upper figures, the image of the supernova remnant is telling us that the central source became much brighter after the emission of this kind of flare. Indeed, our last observation with SWIFT was performed by chance 20 minutes before detection of the flare, and at that time the flux, the persistent flux of the source was a factor 70 higher than in the quiescent level. We performed the target of opportunity observations with Chandra and Windustar, and we observed for the first time a hard component at with a power law shape which extended up to 30 kV. I will show you this is pulsed, and the thermal component, which is beautifully seen, turned out to be much harder than in the quiescent level. Monitoring the decay from the second outburst with SWIFT allowed us to assess the properties of this episode. This is very similar to the previous one, with a slightly smaller overall energy. And here you can see the evolution of the modulation along the 24 kilosecond periodicity. This is the source as seen in quiescent with the scene-like modulation. And this is after this outburst of last year. The pulse shape changed to a more complex shape with two peaks per period. This is seen both in Chandra and in Nustar. So there is almost the same shape in the soft X-ray and in slightly harder range. Very recently, we performed a second observation with Nustar, a few weeks ago. And the light curve changed again to the sinusoidal shape. So it seems the source is relaxing. And here you can see our hard attempt to put all light curves in phase. This is a tricky task since the light curve is changed very much in shape. And so as an attempt, we started from the solution we obtained in 2011 using Swift data, and we extended it using data in the quiescent state, so Chandra data showing the sinusoidal modulation. And then we extrapolated it after the outburst and before the first outburst. And as you can see, the second outburst involved, as I said, a change in the light shape, in shape of the light curve. And interestingly, the sinusoidal shape, which is seen in the most recent NuSTAR observation, is not anymore aligned in phase with the sinusoidal modulation of the quiescent level. It seems within errors, let's say, that there is sort of a 180 shift in phase, as if the outburst switched on an emission area, an emitting area, which is on the opposite side of the star. A very likely counterpart was discovered in the near infrared. It was published by Tendulkar and collaborators. It was discovered in the H-band with HST soon after the 2016 outburst. Very faint, AB magnitude in the H-band 24. And it was not seen in a previous observation with HST with NICMOS. The same source is seen in our images taken with the VLT. This one is not apparent at the same position in all their images. This is a KS band. It's not easy to assess colors of the source because of difficulties in comparing fluxes measured with different instruments on a crowded field, varying observing conditions, uncertainties in the reddening. But in any case, it seems that the properties of the source are broadly consistent with the one of, let's say, typical counterparts of magnetar in outbursts, with a ratio of the infrared to X-ray luminosity around 10 to the minus 5. So, all of the aspects of the phenomenology of the source can be fit rather easily within a magnetar scenario. The millisecond hard X-ray flare and its spectrum, the large outburst in persistent emission, the changing spectral shape with the appearance of the hard power law, the changes in pulse shape and pulse fraction, the overall energetics of the outburst, the fainting of the counter. Of course, what is not easy to understand is the period of 24 kiloseconds. It's hard to believe that this was a magnetar born with that period, and so we need for a mechanism to slow down the rotation of a neutron star to that super slow rate in, let's say, a few thousand years. And it seems that a more promising picture is that involving propeller interaction with the fallback disk. Even if there is a recent investigation by Rosgold Baperna and collaborators which argued that it's quite difficult to believe that the large disk survive around active magnetars, there are recent papers, for example, the one by Hoy and Anderson, we show that a very small amount of matter could be enough to break down, as needed, a neutron star in the right time scale, but provided the neutron star has a very large dipole field, around 5 times 10 to the 15 Gauss. Other possibilities that are worth exploring is that propeller interaction appeared in an earlier phase of fallback accretion. This was proposed by Sergei Popov and collaborators, and we also proposed it in our paper published in the Outburst. In any case, no detailed computation have been performed so far to explore this scenario. So it seems that we have a framework to interpret this source, but it seems like it is a very peculiar, possibly unique source. And so I move on to the next small sample of CCOs, still looking for an explanation of CCOs as a class. I will talk about the so-called antimagnetars. A key discovery by the Columbia group, Jules Alpern and Eric Gottelf, has been the detection of pulsation and the measurement of the period derivative for three sources of the sample, the one inside PAPSA, the one inside PKS1209, and the one inside CAS79. These are three rather fast pulsars, 100 milliseconds, 400 milliseconds, 100 milliseconds, and the period derivative is very small, very small. On the one side, this required a very large observational effort in order to measure this effect by means of phase coherent timing technique. Implications of the measure are very important. First of all, the dipole field that results from the P dot is very small, 10 to the 10 to 10 to the 11 Gauss. Second implication is that the characteristic age of the sources exceeds by a huge factor the age of the host remnant. Characteristic ages of order of hundreds of million years, while the age of remnants are of the order of thousands of years. Third implication is that the X-ray luminosity of the sources cannot be in some way powered by rotation, since the spin-down luminosity is very small for all of the sources. So the framework we have to face is that these are isolated neutron stars with a weak default field. Their position in the PP dot diagram is here, and since the CCOs and magnetars are sitting on opposite sides with respect to the bulk of the neutron star population detected as a radio pulsar, Eric Gottelf called these objects antimagnetars. I will spend a few words to review the phenomenology of the three antimagnetars, since there are very interesting points that are helping us to understand their nature. The source in PKS1209 has a spectrum which displays several absorption features superimposed to the usual double black body continuum. Those features have harmonically spaced energies, and their nature has been somehow debated in the literature, but after the measurement of the P dot, the cyclotron interpretation, cyclotron by electron, seems to be the proper one, since the expected energy of the fundamental is very close to 0.7 keV. The B field computed by the cyclotron interpretation is around 8 times 10 to the 10 Gauss, while the default field from the spin down is around 10 to the 11 Gauss. Another very peculiar point here is that the modulation we see for this object is almost entirely due to the phase modulation of the features. The continuum is not pulsating. It's pulsating at, let's say, 2 to 3% level, while the features are much more modulated at the 50 to 20% level. Going to the CCO in PAPSA, these are light curves above and beyond 1 kV. As you can see, the modulation in this source is in antiphase at soft and hard energies. This is the pulsed fraction as a function of the energy, as you can see, around 1.2 kV, it goes to zero. This is a very peculiar behavior, indeed preventing detection of the modulation when using the whole dataset from XMM. And it could be explained by assuming that the thermal emitting pattern is peculiar. We need the two regions with different areas and different temperatures sitting at the opposite sides of the neutron star. And the large anisotropy which is required on the surface of the neutron star, of course, it's at odds with the expectation for a weakly magnetized source. This is the spectrum. Again, it is well fit by the usual double blackbody curve, but there is also a feature at low energy. It could be described either as an emission line or as a couple of absorption lines. Here, the cyclotron interpretation is not indeed very pointing to the correct value of the field, at least the expected cyclotron energy for the spin-down magnetic field is 0.2 kV at the equator. But in any case, this does not seem a problem in interpreting them, the feature as a cyclotron scattering. Another piece of evidence is that the feature is very likely variable as a function of the time. It is variable as a function of the phase, rotational phase, but also as a function of the time. It seems that the feature changed in energy and also in intensity on the time scale of, let's say, 10 years. The last antimagnetar that I'm mentioning is the one in KES-79. Here the spectrum is featureless. Two black bodies, small emitting areas, as usual, and very large pulsation, 65% pulse fraction. The spectral shape in this source does not depend on the pulse phase. And this is another peculiar aspect of the phenomenology. This can be explained by an emitting pattern with two hotspots which are collocated on the surface. The hotter one is inside the cooler area, and the rest of the surface is essentially emitting no X-rays. Slavko Bogdanov, who performed this kind of modeling, also pointed that emission should be beamed in some way to achieve a high pulse fraction. Both the peculiar surface emitting pattern and the beaming are not expected in a weakly magnetized neutron star. So I go back to the original problem, what are CCOs? And this is the list of CCOs, 13 sources, including a couple of candidate CCOs. And these are the sources that I've been describing, the RCW-103 magnetar and the three antimagnetars. As I said, possibly the peculiar magnetar in RCW-103 is a unique source. And there is the possibility that other CCOs are magnetar. Maybe yes, I will say. But for the moment, let's assume that the better template to explain CCOs are class is provided by the three antimagnetars. So we can explore the possibility that the weak dipole field is the physical basis of the CCO class. In this picture, we have to face some difficulties. The first one is the peculiar thermal map. As I said, it's not easy to explain why a weakly magnetized neutron star should have very large surface temperature anisotropies. Different explanations have been proposed. Spin-down power is not enough. Accretion is ruled out by timing. Possibility of localized injection of energy by magnetic field decay as in magnetars, well, we possibly should observe some variability, but indeed, in the case of RCW-103, we did. This seems not the better solution for steady sources, as the rest of the CCOs. And so, a solution is that the X-ray luminosity is powered by residual cooling of residual heat, And what we need is an isotropic transfer of the heat from the core of the neutron star, which requires, of course, a strong magnetic field in the crust. A toroidal component of the order 10 to the 14 Gauss is needed to screen heat transfer towards the equator of the star. And this should be coupled to a poloidal component at least 3 orders of magnitude smaller in intensity. This is the configuration of the field that is needed to explain the sources as weakly magnetized neutron star. Another problem with the weakly magnetized picture is that concerning origin and evolution of CCOs. As was mentioned before me by Samar and by Adriana, CCOs are frequently formed, and we can say this by simply counting how many of these sources are inside supernova remnants and comparing this number to the number of other classes of sources, radio pulsars or magnetars. They could be more frequently formed than magnetars. Their magnetic field is weak, and if it is constant, we would expect to have a sort of overdensity of sources in the region surrounding the 3 antimagnetars, supposing that at least some of them emit in the radio band. But we do not. This is an underpopulated region. And the related issue is that if one uses the birth rate estimates for different classes of neutron stars and compare them to the overall collapse supernova rate, well, the two numbers do not agree, and we have too many neutron stars. And so this was an argument put by Keane and Kramer, suggesting that evolutionary links are needed in order to solve this issue. Which are the frameworks for a weakly magnetized neutron star? Halpern and Gottlieb suggested that CCOs could be weakly magnetized at birth because of an inefficient dynamo mechanism in a slowly rotating proton-neutron star. But it seemed not appealing since CCOs are not that slowly rotating, and this does not help to solve other issues in the phenomenology. Another possibility is that we are facing with a sort of quiescent magnetars with a very, very weak dipole field. There is the argument of variability. A third possibility, which has already been discussed before me by Samar and Adriana, is that there is an important role in from fallback accretion. This is the so-called hidden magnetic field scenario. Prompt accretion of fallback material could bury the magnetic field and confine it in the crust of the neutron star, and the magnetic field could then re-emerge by diffusion on a time scale that would depend on the amount of the accreted matter. And there are several works that explore the possibility, and they point out that around 10^-3 solar masses of accreted material could be enough to screen strong fields, and that the time scale for re-emergence could be in the range of 1,000 to tens of thousands of years. This would imply that central compact objects, if are born with this mechanism, could turn later in normal pulsars or even in high magnetic field pulsars or magnetars. And this would solve possibly the birth rate problem. It is a scenario which is very difficult to be tested using timing, at least in the X-rays, since it would be needed to measure the breaking index for these sources, which have a very small spin-down rate, and so it is very hard as an exercise. There is some supporting evidence for this scenario, observationally, from radio pulsar timing. The small breaking index for a few very young pulsars have been interpreted as an evidence for a growing magnetic field, and there is some further support in the absence of evidence of weakly magnetized neutron star in high mass X-ray binaries. But in that case, we must say that there is a large fraction of sources for which we have no information about the magnetic field. The hidden magnetic field scenario triggered searches for descendants of CCOs in other classes of neutron stars. And so there were searches using Chandran XMM for anomalously high temperature in mildly recycled pulsar or in seemingly old pulsars, positional coincidence with supernova remnants, or in weak field pulsars, let's say pulsars that sit in a region close to the CCO1s, but no one was found. Searches are still ongoing for CCO descendants among seemingly older pulsars with larger magnetic fields. A possibility that we could consider is that possibly the timescale for reactivation of the pulsar mechanism is larger than expected, or that CCO descendants are indeed radioquiet. And there is a peculiar source dubbed Calvera. It was discovered and proposed to be an addition to the magnificent 7 X-ray dim isolated neutron stars. Later, it turned out to be a sort of peculiar rotation-powered pulsar with a high spin-down luminosity, around several times 10 to the 35 works per second. But it is not seen neither in radio nor in the gamma rays. It only emits thermal-like X-rays. And so it was proposed to be an evolved CCO. But indeed, the age and the distance of this source are almost totally unconstrained. It is at very high galactic latitude, and so it's not possible to conclude that this is a descendant of a CCO. It is radioquiet in any case. So I came to conclusion. The sample of CCOs that were initially a disappointing sample of boring sources is proving to include very interesting sources, and the interpretation is providing hints in order to go towards a unified theory linking different classes of neutron stars. This theory should give an important role to fallback accretion and to the interaction of the neutron star with the fallback material in a range of different regimes and with different magnetic field configuration, of course. This is a scenario that has many parameters, and it will be difficult to constrain it using observations, but indeed, on the observational point of view, there is a lot of work that can be done with existing facilities and with future observatories. For instance, we have to monitor CCO pulsars to see deviations from their steady spin down. We can search for pulsations in the large majority of CCO sources, which have not very constraining upper limits in this. We have to search for long-term X-ray variability, which could unveil that a few of them are magnetar. Indeed, the possibility that a few of them are quiescent magnetar cannot be ruled out on the basis of simple spectroscopy. Are they radioquiet or simply radiofaint? We do not indeed know, and possibly with future observatories it will be possible to assess this issue. We have to continue searching about possibility for their descendants and for new members, for instance with the Rosita, as Adriana said. And clues to the evolution can come also from timing, radio pulsars, and other classes of neutron stars. There's a lot that still need to be done regarding specific sources, and we have lots of data for the 3 antimagnetars, and possibly for them it could be possible to perform some sort of very detailed modeling and to infer the magnetic field topology, which could be an important ingredient in order to understand their nature. Okay, I stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this excellent review. We have time for a few questions. Oleg?
For RCW 103 source, was there any evidence of spectral features in any observations in any states?
Well,
have you checked?
Yes, I did not mention that we have a deep observation performed with XMN Newton after the second outburst. And of course, we had a look in this data. And well, to be to be frank, if you look at the plot that you can obtain by making the histogram of energy versus phase of collected photons, well, you would like to see a feature there, but it's not easy at all to constrain these using phase-resolved spectroscopy. So, yes, I would like to believe there is a feature, but possibly we cannot say that there is as a unique explanation for the evolution of the spectrum as a function of the phase.
Any, Ali?
Thank you for the very interesting talk. I want to make a comment about fallback. Now, fallback accretion is coming in, is suggested that in various connections. I want to point out that the assumption that it's spherical to bury the field and for the field to come back has a number of problems. First of all, the statistics and the connection with the supernova rates already suggests that there are evolutionary connections between these classes. And then to assume that every case where you employ fallback is actually spherical, which should be rather unusual in a supernova, compounds the problem of the statistics. And secondly, if you allow for the fallback to carry some angular momentum, then it would remain in a disk and it would regulate the evolution for an extended period of time, and it would explain the period regularities. And in the presence of a fallback disk, the torque on the neutron star is not a dipole torque. And you can easily explain the seemingly anomalous breaking indices with a fallback disk scenario that's consistent with explaining the period and the period derivative and the second derivative and luminosity. All of that said, I think the reason the CCOs are very interesting, in particular RCW-103, is it's so exceptional and way out from the regularity in periods of all the AXPs and SGRs and the dim isolated stars that it really is going to be, I think, very important. My colleague Ünal Ertan has the codes with fallback disks which he can successfully apply to the dim isolated neutron stars, AXPs, SGRs, but so far not in detail to the source, yes, in RCW-103. So that's really a challenge. Thank you.
Any other questions? Go ahead.
As I said, we have a detection of this source in the KS and H band, but these are from different instruments, different epochs, and it's not easy to say which is the difference in flux between the two near-infrared band, so it's not possible to say if it's brighter in the KS or in the H band intrinsically after the reddening. In any case, what seems to be a conclusion is that the flux in the near-infrared is around 10 to the minus 5 times the flux in the soft X-rays, and so this kind of ratio is the one that is observed for several other magnetar candidates when they are in active state. So this is the only strong conclusion, let's say, if this is a conclusion that we can have from this data. It's not possible, indeed, to talk about colors of this source.
Okay, one very last question from George.
It is actually a continuation of Yura's question. If, do you understand right, that if you plot X-ray spectrum and those one or two points in the infrared, flux densities, yes, and connect them with the power law, what would be the slope?
I didn't try. Admit, I didn't try to connect them with the power law you see in the X-rays with NuSTAR. Okay. So we can check.
Okay, lots of interesting questions. I had a burning one, but I'll postpone my question for later. So we have to move. Thank you very much again, Andrea. So our